In this video, I'm going to discuss some basic properties of caches, and then I'll move on to various cache innovations in the next videos. So the first thing we need to understand is, you know, what leads to a cache miss. And once you understand that, you can then introduce innovations to either reduce miss rate or reduce miss penalty. Okay, so there are different kinds of cache misses, and they're usually referred to as the three C's: the compulsory misses, the capacity misses, and the conflict misses. Okay, so what's a compulsory miss? So usually the way programs behave is, or the way programs and caches behave is that the program makes a request for data, those are brought into the cache, and then hopefully some of the data is retained in the cache so that when you touch it again, those end up being cache hits. Okay, so even if I used an infinitely sized cache, I'm still going to have some misses early in the program, right? The first time I touch data, it is unlikely to be in cache, right? So things have to first be brought into cache before you can enjoy subsequent cache hits. Okay, so in some sense, compulsory misses are misses that are created the first time you access some data. Okay, now thankfully for us, every time there's a miss, right? So if I'm trying to access variable A, the first time I touch it, it's going to be a compulsory miss. But thankfully, when I bring things into the cache, it is at the granularity of a cache block, right? So a cache block could be 32 bytes or 64 bytes. And so when there's a miss, I bring in an entire 32-byte chunk into my cache, right? So all the neighboring variables that also happen to reside in the same cache block get brought into the cache for free in some sense. Or when I touch variable B for the first time, this ends up being a cache hit, right? So even though I'm touching, you know, B, C, and D for the first time, because they got brought into the cache along with A, those end up being cache hits. Okay, so because of the fact that programs exhibit spatial locality, and because of the fact that I bring in a large cache block into the cache at a time, not every first access to a data element ends up being a compulsory miss. It is only the first access to a given block that leads to a compulsory miss. Okay, so one way to reduce compulsory misses is to increase my block size. Because if I go from a 32-byte block to a 64-byte block, I'm effectively doing a prefetch for more data elements, right? And that should lead to fewer misses for those data elements. Okay, so, you know, in addition to using a larger block size, I can also try to use some kind of sophisticated prefetch mechanism that predicts what is going to be accessed next and tries to bring that in before the CPU issues that request. Then the next kind of miss is called a capacity miss. Okay, and this is best explained with an example. So let's say that I access block A, and then I start accessing blocks, you know, B, C, D, and so on, and then much later in time, I again touch block A. Okay, so now the question before me is this next access to A going to be a cache hit or a cache miss? Okay, and it depends on how many different blocks I touch between those consecutive accesses to A. Okay, so if I have touched, you know, let's say 800 different unique blocks before I touch A again, then I need to also now look at my cache size. Okay, let's see how large my cache is. If my cache is large enough to accommodate 1024 different blocks, then I would expect, you know, this access to be a cache hit. Okay, because, you know, all I'm doing is touching A and 800 other different blocks. There's enough place to retain all of these blocks, right? So this should be a cache hit. Instead, if my block had, if my cache had only 512 different blocks, then I would expect this next access to A to be a cache miss, because, you know, at least one of these 800 different blocks should have displaced A from cache. So the next lookup of A should yield a cache miss, right? So if this is a miss, then I can say that this is because of a lack of capacity in my cache, right? So I would now designate this miss as being a capacity miss, because I'm touching 800 different blocks and my cache can only accommodate 512 blocks. So this is a miss because of a lack of capacity in my cache. Okay, instead, let's also look at a conflict miss now. Okay, so if I did have 1024 blocks in my cache and I still encounter a miss for A, now the miss is not happening because of a lack of capacity, right? Because if my cache is well organized, if my data access pattern is uniform, that is, I'm touching every single set an equal number of times, then, you know, this access to A should yield a cache hit, because I'm only touching, you know, 800 different blocks, and there's enough space in my cache to retain A and all of these 800 other different blocks. Okay, so now if I have a miss, it is because, you know, many of these blocks ended up being mapped to the same set, and hence, you know, there was competition for that one set, and that resulted in A being evicted from cache. Between a reuse of A, I look at how many different unique blocks I'm touching. If that number is higher than the number of blocks that can be accommodated in cache, then it's a capacity miss. Else, it's going to be a conflict miss. Okay, so this is how I would characterize different misses, as either being compulsory, capacity, conflict. Another useful guideline to help me make this classification is to look at the misses with an infinite cache. Those are the compulsory misses. Then when I move from an infinite cache to a fully associative cache, those are the misses because of capacity reasons. Then when I move from a fully associative cache to a direct map cache, or say a two-way cache, then those additional misses are because of conflicts. Okay, because a fully associative cache does the best job possible in trying to handle conflicts, right? It says I'll have a single set, all blocks are mapped over here, and I'll do my best job of somehow retaining the 512 most recently accessed blocks. Okay, and if I move from here to a cache that is direct mapped, you know, those misses are now caused by, you know, two accesses mapping to the same entry. Right, so you know, this really exposes all the misses that are being caused because of conflicts. Okay, so you know, what have we learned from this analysis? What it tells us is, if I use a large block size, it should reduce compulsory misses. If I have high spatial locality, it should also reduce the misses or the miss penalty for all the neighboring data elements as well. Okay, but it can lead to an increase in conflict misses possibly. It also leads to, you know, more traffic between the different levels of cache. It can also waste some space because I'm bringing in this entire block and not all elements inside that block are going to be touched, right? So it leads to some amount of underutilization in my cache. Then if I use a large cache, that should definitely reduce, you know, capacity and conflict misses, possibly even my compulsory misses. But a large cache also takes longer to access, which is why, you know, using a larger cache is an option only when you get to the L2 or L3 or lower levels of the hierarchy. If you also use high associativity, that should reduce your conflict misses. And you know, people have observed that if you have, say, a 32 kilobyte cache which is two-way set associative, that has the same miss rate as a direct mapped 64 kilobyte cache. Okay, so when you go from one-way to two-way, there's such a steep drop in conflict misses that you could even reduce your cache size by half and still have the same miss rate as before. Okay, but you know, once you go from two-way to four-way, the drop in conflict misses is not as much. Okay, so the law of marginal returns kind of kicks in, and so you will see, you know, less of a drop in conflict misses as you go from, you know, two-way to four-way to eight-way and so on.